in terms of what role it plays, you know, in the aging process, you know, it seems as though, at least in some of the studies that I've seen, that mitochondrial function really seems to be important. And
yes.
I know that you've shown that the sirtuin 3 in the mitochondria itself seems to be really important for the mitochondrial function, keeping your mitochondria young. And yes. that mitochondria play a very important role in aging as well.
A critical role. The, you know, many of the aging pathways that we know, be it the unfolded protein response or mitochondrial biogenesis, all point to efficient mitochondria as one of the key ways to stay young. And one reason is because this is a way, so you can generate energy from glycolysis, which is glucose, carbohydrates, mm-hmm. which is we know is linked to aging, but also via mitochondria, via a process called oxidative phosphorylation. And that process is not necessarily depending on glucose, but is dependent on an efficient mitochondrial function. So we talked about NAD-dependent enzyme. Many of these enzymes reside in the mitochondria. And we found that, for example, the NAD supplementation that is being tested in a variety of aging model requires SIRT3 quite often.
This mitochondrial
sirtuin, yes.
Nicotinamide riboside does?
Yes, yes. For example, the paper we've published was focused on the age-associated or noise-induced loss of hearing. So if you actually subject mice or humans to very acute hearing, acute noise, they have a dose-dependent loss of hearing. You can protect mice completely from this effect by supplementing with NAD.
Wow.
But with nicotinamide riboside. So if you're going to a rock concert,
right,
and you want to protect yourself, and this is definitely something
Harley Davidson riders.
Yes. In mice, it actually had an enormous effect. And we found that this effect was dependent on SIRT3. So in SIRT3 knockout mice, the effect was lost.
Do you know if if that was the SIRT3 in the mitochondria of stem cells, because or was it just any cell, or do
so
you not know?
In the case of hearing loss, it's dependent on some really uniquely sensitive cells, okay. in the inner ear. But generally, there's been a sort of an assumption in the field that most of the effect of nicotinamide riboside's protective effect are dependent on SIRT1. I think in
oh really
in, yes, and in some cases it is. In this particular case, noise-induced hearing loss, it was really clearly SIRT3.
So even the studies that have looked at, for example, I think there's there was a mouse that had some sort of mitochondrial disorder.
Yes.
Even that one was dependent on SIRT1.
No, actually, I did not. In that case, I think the assumption was that it might be helping global mitochondrial function. And so there's a growing number of cases, and for example, DNA damage associated disease, where you see accelerated aging, where people have been testing the effect of supplementation, because those conditions are associated with increased PARP activity, just like you uh-huh. mentioned. And in those cases, I think it hasn't always been clearly mapped what is the real target of NAD that is dependent on for the beneficial effect.
Do you know if so NAD levels do decrease with age? Do you know, has it been looked at, like, for example, in animals, like in rodents, when they're fasted, because fasting increases NAD, when they're fasting and they're older, does that help rejuvenate the NAD irrespective of their age? Does it?
I don't know the answer to that question. It's a good question. I think, you know, one thing that I remember also about fasting, another critical effect of fasting that is really essential in our thinking, is autophagy.
Yes.
And so, you know, there's growing evidence also that autophagy by itself responds to nutrient availability. Mm-hmm. So NAD levels, acetyl-CoA levels. Mm-hmm. This is a new area that people are starting to work in, and including my labs, trying to understand what is it about acetyl-CoA, which is another, think about the currency exchanger in the cells, intermediary metabolite, that appears to have not only role as a nutrient, but also as a signaling mm-hmm. molecule. Acetyl-CoA is in the Krebs cycle. It's one of the key intermediary products of the Krebs cycle. But it's also the substrate for a whole family of enzymes called the acetyltransferases, which are the opposite of what we were talking about, the HDACs, earlier. So
Yeah,
I think
yeah.
there's really a lot of crosstalk between all of these pathways, and we're working very actively now on modulation of signaling via acetyl CoA and these acetyl transferases. Is yet another approach is to mimic calorie restriction in the right. fasting state.
Yeah, I had Dr. Guido Kramer on the podcast.
Yes, exactly.
And he has been studying that as well. You know, it brings up a question I remember I wanted to ask you that was sort of, you know, biology is never just black and white, because I remember him with his work, he was talking about how important decreasing protein acetylation was. So
yes.
for activating autophagy, which happens yes. during fasting, but also during fasting, you have these beta hydroxybutyrate, which is now was a class two inhibitor?
Class one inhibitor
of the histone deacetylase, yes. which is kind of the opposite a little.
No, because you have to think, so beta hydroxybutyrate, it's one step above the sirtuins. And actually the class one inhibitors are inhibitors of
that makes sense. Okay.
And so it fits perfectly if you go back to the
class one is an inhibitor of
yes.
histone deacetylase. Yes. That makes sense now.
Yes.
Okay.
So
thank you. There was a disconnect in my brain when I was trying to
you know, because it so the whole idea of if you think about acetyl CoA and we really draw a graph that of acetyl CoA regulating HATs, histone acetyltransferase, and NAD regulating the sirtuins. Mm-hmm. And these enzymes quite often say in opposition, not all of them, but one of the key players in terms of histone acetyltransferase is P300. And that's the one we've worked on, and Guido Kramer as well has worked on. And it makes sense. You get the same beneficial effects by activating a sirtuins, which lowers acetylation, as you do by inhibiting an acetyltransferase, which also lowers acetylation. Mm-hmm. So the message is that nutrient feeding or, you know, low histone acetyltransferase activity or high sirtuin activity all lead to low protein acetylation, which is beneficial.
And doing the ketogenic diet
regulates one step above.
Does also, yeah.
Yes. But obviously there's some complexity because there are some histone marks that are depending on one enzyme. So this is an oversimplified model, but so far it holds.